In this video, I will walk you through the import and assembly of a set of MLST trace files. My dataset contains 140 SCF trace files from the organism Neisseria. In order to import and assemble these trace files in one import round, the trace files should be present in the same folder, and the file names should be composed of the sample name and the name of the housekeeping gene experiments. In my example database, I press the import button in the toolbar and select the option Import and Assemble Trace Files in the import tree. In the first step, I need to browse for the files. I select my files and click Open. All files are displayed in the input dialog. The way the information should be imported in the database needs to be specified with an import template. I can select one of the default templates or create my own. As this is the first time I will import and assemble trace files in this database, I will create a new import template. The only source of information available in the newly created template is the file name. I will link the file name to the BioNumerics key field. I make sure the row is selected in the grid and I can click on Edit Destination. If I now press the Preview button, I can check the rule that I have defined so far. From the preview, I can see that not the complete file name should be linked to the key field, but only the part that appears before the first underscore. I check the option Show Advanced Options. I make sure the row is selected in the grid and press the Edit Parsing button. In this dialog, I need to specify which part of the file name should be retained as key information. This parsing string will omit all text appearing after the underscore. The correct part of the file names is linked to the key field. The sequence experiment names can also be parsed from the file names. I will now add a second rule that will link this information to sequence experiments in my database. I select Add Rule. I select file name as my starting point and sequence type as my data destination. The text appearing between the first underscore and the hyphen corresponds to the sequence name. Preview shows me that the correct part of the file names is linked to the sequence type names. In the last step, I need to specify a name for my template. My template is now added to the database. In the preview window, I can see that all information is parsed correctly with my template. I make sure my newly created template is selected and I can go to the next step. I confirm the creation of my entries and press Next to go to the final step. In the final step, I can specify some additional settings for the processing of my trace files. Pressing the Trimming Settings button allows me to define the start and stop patterns for each experiment. In this database, the patterns have already been defined, so there is no need to change this information. pressing the assembly settings buttons allows me to change the assembly settings for each individual experiment. For this exercise, I will use the default settings so I can just close the windows. The final step is to click Finish and the software will start assembling the selected trace files. Once the assembly is complete, an overview report will appear. The overview panel displays the entries as rows and the experiments as columns. Each cell provides information about the current status of a project. In my example, most sequences were assembled correctly and the corresponding cells have a green color. One cell has a red color. When I click on the cell, the details are updated in the details panel on the right-hand side. When I double-click on the message, the assembly window opens. The consensus sequence is shown in the upper line and the individual traces that contribute to the consensus are displayed below. Different goals at the same position results in three unresolved bases in the consensus. These unresolved bases in the consensus are displayed in pink. I can look at the curves to check the base calling, or I can screen the consensus sequence for the nearest allele matches. This is done with MLST Identify Allele. The identification result is shown in a new window. The best matched alleles are displayed in the allele ID column. A second table is displayed on the right part of the window, listing the sequence differences between the consensus and the selected allele ID. In this assembly, 4 mismatches are reported with allele ID 9. I will update the consensus according to the editing suggestions. Changing the incorrect base in one of the trace files updates the consensus sequence automatically. The consensus should now have a perfect match with allele ID 9. I will save all changes to the database and close the assembly window. The cell is updated and is displayed in green. One cell still has an orange color. It is not required to check this assembly, but still it is recommended. I can open the assembly by double-clicking on the cell. At 2 positions, there is only one base contributing to the consensus. I can have a look at the curves to check the base calling. There are 2 missing bases in the upper trace file. Optionally, I can update the base calling. I will close the overview report window with file exit. The window can be called again with the menu item, analysis, sequence types, batch assembly reports. The entries are displayed in the database entries panel and are automatically selected. For each experiment defined in the database, there is a column present in the experiment presence panel. A colored dot is displayed if a sequence is present for an entry experiment combination. To view the consensus sequence of a certain entry experiment combination, I can click on the corresponding color dot while holding down the Shift key. The assembly window can be called by clicking on this button. The sequence editor can be called by clicking on the color dot. The assembly window can be called by clicking this button. Information on how to screen the consensus sequences against existing MLST sequences is illustrated in another video.